Welcome everyone to this podcast, A Conversation with a Mentor. This podcast is presented to you by Breuel Gen, the Younger Leaders Generation Initiative of the Lausanne Movement. We want to build soul friendship for global missions through whole life mentoring. And today we are pleased to have as co-host Delphine Fanfan from Cameroon. Hello, Delphine.
Hi, Paul.
Hello, and we are pleased to have also Mark Slaughter from the United States. Hi, Mark.
Hello, Paul. Good to see you.
For today's podcast, we are really thrilled to have with us one of the Lausanne Movement's younger generation leaders in the person of Sarah Breuel. Sarah served as the director for YLG16, the gathering of young people that met in Jakarta. And she has also served in evangelism training as coordinator for IFES Europe. Sarah was born in Brazil. She's involved in church planting in Rome, together with her husband, Renee, and their two boys. Currently, Sarah serves as the director of Revive Europe. What a pleasure and a privilege it is to have Sarah joining us today.
Welcome, Sarah. It's so good to have you here. You and I have known each other a little bit through various ministries and so on, but welcome to our podcast. It's so good to have you, Sarah.
Oh, I'm delighted to be here. Mark, Della, and Paul, thanks for having me.
Oh, you're quite welcome. So, well, I know many people know you, Sarah, from your leading the YLG16 Younger Leaders Gathering in Jakarta, but many people may not know you as well. Could you give us just a brief summary of kind of your life, where you grew up, and how you came to faith and your call to ministry? Can you just introduce yourself a little bit to people of those early years up till, let's say, your mid-20s a little bit?
Absolutely. So I was raised in the south of Brazil. My family, they're Christian, so I was had a privilege of being raised in a church and going to camps as a little girl already, and moved to study business in São Paulo and in the university. And my calling to cross-cultural missions happened as a young girl when I was about 12 years old in a Christian camp. And it was real though, and I just knew by then that cross-cultural missions was what God had for me. Got to marry my best husband, my best friend, Rene. We've met in business school and we've been married. This year will be 15 years. And yeah, together been serving here in Italy for 11 years soon.
That's hard to believe, isn't it? Oh my. Well, he is a dear man. I've sure enjoyed times with him as well. So what a wonderful guy and a beautiful family. Now, you know, on our last podcast, we had Dr. Leighton Ford, who chaired the Lausanne Movement for many years. And he was sharing with us about back in the early 80s, he began to sense a heart for developing younger leaders in the Lausanne Movement. And that led to the first younger leader gathering in Singapore in 1987. And really, to be honest, all of us and you, in this case, talking about you, we're fruit of that vision and dream that he had way back then. Could you tell with me just a little bit about who some of your early mentor, maybe some of your key mentors were, and you're really part of that legacy and the ongoing fruit of Leighton's original dream back in the 80s. How has your story connected with Leighton Ford and kind of that early dream of younger leaders?
Absolutely. It was such a treat to listen to Leighton podcast. If I can just say, if you haven't listened yet, pause this. His podcast was amazing. And it was just pearl after pearl. And listen to his story in the 80s, particularly when he was flying over the Pacific and felt a stirring from God, just looking around the Lausanne Movement and seeing most, you know, gray hair, other generation, and thinking, and just feeling a stir from God to invest in the new generation. And as I was listening to Leighton yet again in that podcast, I was almost brought back to tears, because to see the Lausanne Movement after how he was obedient to that calling, and how many of us actually this podcast and YLG 87, YLG 2006, YLG 16, it's fruit of that calling. And for me, it's incredibly meaningful, because I came across, when I was 25 years old, I was studying theology with Renee in Region College, Canada. And then out of the blue, I received this email that a group of mentors was putting back together in part of Leighton Ford Ministries group, and inviting me if I'd be willing to join that group. And my first reaction was like, Jackpot, this sounds amazing. You know, just hearing about the other women there and the mentors. And that was 13 years ago, my first contact with Leighton for Ministries. And through Leighton and that group, it has literally had a, you know, before and after impact in my life.
That's tremendous. Well, I know that Ann Grizzle was leading that group and has and still leads it. But yeah. It's been such a community for you. In fact, one time I was with Ann just before or right after you came, I think, is your group. And you guys come from all over the world. Tell me a little bit about what role the group has meant to you, Sarah, in terms of how have you seen this group, even though Ann put it together, how have you seen this community, this group shape you and your life and ministry and calling?
Yes, absolutely. So first of all, it was, for me, already the start was significant because the only reason that I'm out in that group is completely by grace. I'll just give the example of it. And Grizzle, the person, the mentor who was putting together, she wanted women from all over the world. So she wrote to Regent College and say, you know, do you have any women from different parts of the world? And they send a list of like 10 women. And I was one in the list and there was nothing about me besides Brazil besides. So it's just my name and Brazil and other women in the list. And Anne had a heart for Brazil. So she said, I love Brazil. I don't know who this Sarah is, but I'll write her. And that's the only reason I'm in the group, for no credit whatsoever. So that was just powerful for me to experience that grace. So it's a group where, we've been meeting once a year for 13 years now. And the first impression, I mean, when we got together, we were in Washington, D.C. in this retreat center. The idea was let's meet for 3 times, potentially to meet for a lifetime. And I'm like, wow, this is intense. But I mean, it really became a second family. And what I experienced in that group is just incredible freedom in having people that you journey through life that know my very best and my very worst. And I can have all the, you know, be vulnerable as I can in that group and feel that it's safe to have people that are there, that we love each other and that we're there for one another, not for the organizations that we're working or for other people. We're just there to journey together for life. And I just feel incredibly privileged to have women that know me in that level of what are my struggles, what are my passions, what I feel I was created for. And I know them and they speak truth to my life and I speak truth to their life. And together we search God's voice together for one another. So it has been life-changing, as I said.
Oh, it sure sounds like it. And personally, as well as in your ministry and your calling, what a family. You know what? So often we think about mentoring as one-on-one, but I think a lot of times we miss the value of a group and the dynamic of meeting together in this unique model once a year for a retreat. Of course, I'm assuming you guys are in touch in between that throughout the year with Zoom calls or other prayer updates or even ministry. But we often forget and don't think about having a group. Could you help kind of just even paint a picture for a minute for someone that maybe has never experienced a group? Describe kind of what it's like when you guys get together over those 4 or 5 days. What types of, how do you use your time when you're together, and what has been really most impactful for you in when your groups meet together?
Yeah, absolutely. It's very much, it also helps that in my calendar, I know that I have set aside 4 or 5 days just for retreat. So it changes even, you know, the atmosphere. As soon as I board the airplane to go to that place, I'm already like, God, it's just us and these women. I just set my ears and my soul in a different way that I'm setting aside time to God, for me and God, and for my friends there. And it's in nature, so it's very also a time of resting. We take silent retreats as well, so we have some time of silence. So basically the purpose of the group is to facilitate times to have individually with us and God, which God has used throughout the years to really speak in my life. You know, and going back to that same place, there's something about this thin place or a place that you have encountered God before. It's like you step into this whole history of God, what God has been speaking to you. But then the heart of the group is each person has a time of sharing. So we have about 30 minutes to the person. And then there we just, you know, open our souls of what we're going through, you know, and really be what we're really wrestling the moment, things that we're thinking through, where we're trying to listen God's voice, something that we have been struggling, just share our hearts. And then after that, have a time of silence, listening to God for one another and have them speaking to my life. And then we go each person speaking to each other's life. But there's something about the community searching God's voice together and through doing this longevity of people that have seen you. You know, in 13 years, I moved countries, I had children, I moved ministries, but they know my core. They know what God created me to be and my struggles and my joys, and I don't theirs. So they can call me out, you know, the best of me and what God has for me, and I can call theirs. So there's something about really iron sharpens iron in the best of senses when you have that. So it is really a gift.
Well, they know your story, don't they? They just absolutely know each chapter that keeps unfolding year after year. And there's no substitute for some people that have known us intimately like that for decades or for multiple years. That's so beautiful. You were talking about safe places and having those places that you can go to that have spiritual memory there, where you've really met God. It's a powerful thing. And God has really met you there, even in terms of some ministry calling aspects too, and clarity, getting discernment. Can you describe a little bit about how God's used that group to be able to help even clarify your own ministry and calling at times?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll give one story. Actually, it's connected with YOG. So the last meeting of the group before YOG, we were meeting in the beginning of May 2016. End of April, beginning of May 2016. So that's just, you know, 3 months before the gathering. And in particular, in that time, even if my mind goes back there, it just, all of these emotion comes up because it was a time that we were fundraising for the final scholarships. And I remember being under just incredible pressure, you know, and asking God for provision. And right after that group, in the middle of the group, I received a news that it was not so encouraging about fundraising. And they were there with me. And I was just sharing all what we had been praying for. And I went for a run, you know, a run that I do often that place. And as I was running, I was just, you know, sharing God, like, God, please come through. Like, God, where is this going to come? It just sounded so overwhelming at the time to see how God will come through. And I came back from that run and the ladies prayed with me and I had that memory. And a year after, I remember coming back to that same place and YOG had happened already. And my first run there, I was running and just remembered like how God did it. You know, I was like, God, you did it. Like, it's just celebrating and just like almost shouting out, you know, how faithful God has been. And remembering 1 year after of how he carried us through the end and he was faithful. So I got at the end of that run. It was just like, God, you're so faithful. And just remembering what happened through that year. And it was very meaningful. At the end of that run, there's a bridge. Mark knows that bridge. It's a retreat center down in Belfry. And when I was in that bridge, just opening my heart to God, it was one of the, you know, maybe three encounters that I had in my whole life, that one of them was right there in that bridge, coming there, just encountering God in a very fresh and vivid way. So I'm just so grateful of a God that knows our chapters and unfolds our stories. And when we can look back and have that place to remember, you know, in the people of Israel, there's stones of remembrance of like challenges that they had and God come through. And for me, I think it's meaningful and important to mark those moments, these victories that God won on our behalf, and see his faithfulness. So have this place. It just feels like holy ground for me almost to go back there and running, because I just remember all this history and encountering the Holy Spirit in fresh ways.
Oh, praise God. Yeah. Sarah, I love that story of God meeting you and his faithfulness. And I was actually, when you were saying that, I was thinking of those memory stones in the Old Testament. And that when you come to that bridge or whatever, you remember how God was faithful to provide the financial need and then how he met you at that bridge again. So that is so beautiful. Oh, thanks for sharing your heart. That's just warmed my own heart to hear your passion and the tenderness of how God met you through this mentoring community. You know, Bobby Clinton is an author and he talks about having a mentoring constellation. And I think here you were able to be part of a mentoring group that was initiated by a senior leader, and certainly have times with Anne, and there have been other senior leaders in your life, but sometimes we think about that as the only type of mentoring, where we're part of a group that's maybe led by a senior leader. But we often forget about having other parts of that constellation of like the stars filling out. We have that constellation has older leaders or senior leaders, but there's also peer mentoring or mentoring those that are younger than us. And so that's also a really key part. And what we just described is that first part of that something initiated by a senior leader that formed a community of a lot of peers in your life. So that's a powerful story.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, Mark. And it's just amazing, Sarah. I think the thing about your story that is so encouraging and so worth hearing over and over is this constellation that Mark is talking about, because you haven't only benefited from these older leaders in the mentoring relationships that you have shared, but tell us more now about peer mentoring. You know, when you hear the word peers, sometimes it conjures up all kinds of impressions, all kinds of competition, maybe almost, and even just comparison and stuff like that. But you have been able to, since 2016, with the younger leaders generation, you've been able to not only participate in peer mentoring groups, but to have peer mentoring groups going on from way back then, even up till now. Please tell us more about what your experience has been in these peer mentoring groups and what you consider are the key benefits that you have reaped in this process thus far.
Yeah, thank you, Della. Again, listening to Leighton, it was so meaningful when he was sharing about the planning process from YLG 87 and the younger leaders team getting together and planning. And he said that was, you know, also conflict in the group and they were shaping each other. And I think I just can share, in all honesty, the younger leaders team for 2016, I think it's one of God's most extravagant gifts also in my life, because we've been to such a journey together. We often make a joke among us that it's like we've been to war together. There are things that happen when you go through to war, the stories that you go together, that you create just a different kind of bond, because you've been through so many challenges together. So I love the younger leaders team with all my heart. They are like brothers and sisters to me. And I feel that, you know, like fellow warrior in the, you know, because we've just been through so much together. And planning YOG, it was more than just putting the gathering together, which created also, you know, incredible challenges along the way, but experiencing God's faithfulness in it and seeing each other just blossom into it, and having this deeper commitment to, I think he created, first we get along really well with each other, so that helps, you know, I mean, we have fun together and things, but then as through it, we saw God's calling in each other's lives and seeing each other's flourishing in different ways. So after the gathering was done, like we can just, it felt just too precious. Like, oh, this is done and that's it. It felt like a group from different regions that wants to go. So every year, not every year, sorry, we had a reunion after 3 years of YOG and decided that this group would become a younger later for ministries as well. So we had a current commitment of meeting every 2 years to do exactly what I do with women, you know, just being together, listening to God with one another and praying to one another. And yeah, I just love that group so much.
Wow. It sounds to me like from what you describe, it sounds like this is not just a group of people with common interests. This is a group of people who are willing to risk trusting each other with themselves as much as you trust God together for the common goal that you guys have had. What are some of the, what would I call it? What are some of the most stretching experiences that you have had with this peer group as you guys continue to serve and to work together in this way?
Mm-hmm. I couldn't get the exact word you said, the most stretchy experience. Yeah.
Stretching. Like what has been the most stretching for you as a person, if at all there has been any of such experiences?
Before I answer that, I think one of the things related to this group, I think I'm learning also through my life that more than only what does God call us to in calling, that's obviously their place, but there are people that you call to journey alongside with. And they're as equally important, the people that you allow to speak in your life and you want to be part of their life. So I decided, you know, we grow up with, you know, we're teenagers and university students and we have friends that connect. And but there's a point in my life that like, God, I wanted to be around people that love you as I do, you know, that want your kingdom to come as like. So I found that in the YLT also a common desire of not simply getting along, but we want this generation for Jesus, you know, and having that kind of zeal and have people that have the same love for Jesus and for mission to shape your life and be shaped by their life, I think mm-hmm. it's the iron shaping iron that is just, it's priceless. You don't get that in conferences. Mm-hmm. You don't get that in books. Right. You get inviting the people in your life. In terms of like stretching with while in the process of YLG, my goodness, you name it. It was stretchy to get, you know, the number of participants we were aiming for, or like what is the program we were going through financially, the dates, consensus in the thing. I mean, everything, it's kind of, you get put in a pressure pot, you know, in that, that sense together. Mm-hmm. But in it, I think that really used to, you know, shape one another and to love one another and to do the best of offering something that is God honoring through it with our mistakes, you know, looking back, we've done a ton of mistakes and God is gracious, you know, work through that. But, but the stretching points is almost like what was not stretching.
Wow. So beautiful to have that group. I mean, I'm trying to imagine this in my head because I work in teams a lot too. And I totally can relate with you as far as what is not stretching in this group settings, as a matter of fact. Wow, how amazing. Another part of your constellation is not just the peer groups that you have had the privilege to mentor, but the younger revivalists that you have equally been able to work with in this mentoring journey that you have had. Please share more about that. Perhaps like what is it that draws you towards younger leaders, and how is that relationship built between you and them, so that it becomes mutually edifying as you continue that journey?
Yeah, very happy to share about Revivalist. One last thing about the YOG, though, there's something about Lausanne also being global, that you learn in the global church that you don't learn in your, you know, your own continent. So being exposed to people in the country, it puts a whole new level also into the dynamics, which is a treat to anyone part of the Lausanne movement. For the Revivalist, it's coming out first of a personal journey with revival, you know, kind of actually that story that I gave, coming back into that woods, having a God encounter in that bridge, it was birth of something in my heart. Maybe that's the best, there are really words that I can put to it, but something that God had put in my heart to have just a hunger for him and a desire to see revival in my own heart, in my own life. And it was after YLG, I took a sabbatical, which shaped me deeply. I just took time to rest, be with my voice, you know, with Renee as a family. That was very important. But to listen to God's voice was, I was just starving for that. God was gracious to speak clearly before YLG. It was June 2013 at the airport of Dubai that I had a very special encounter together with that bridge. It's one of, you know, two, three encounters that I cherish in my heart. So for me, YLG, every time that it got hard, I remembered God is in this. I didn't start this. Nobody in the group started. God started this. And I remember he would be faithful because this was his. And to have that confidence of something that he speaks, it shaped me deeply. I was like, I don't want to go to my life without being anchored in a calling that I know that God's breathing on it, it's on it, that I know that God is doing. So I was hungry to hear his voice, and it took 4 months and a half, but spoke to me. And to my surprise, it was about revival and just experiencing revival. And this was new and incredible and confusing all at the same time. It just is so overflow in my heart that I think it might even be a lifelong calling for me to look for revival in this generation, and putting desire in my heart to who are other people, particularly here in Europe, that have been praying for revival, that I believe that God is raising as revivalists, as emerging revivalists in this generation. So I've invited a group of about 11, 12, together with 12 of us. We've met three times online, but because of the pandemic, but we'll meet the first time in person next month. But when we met together, it was the same experience with the YOT, just people, yes, they want the same, you know, revival in their lives. You connect in a vision level that is meaningful and have that. So to see, I believe in this peer mentor because we will all shape one another. We just create space and facilitate and have them shape. So to receive and to shape one another in this way.
Hmm. Wow, as you speak about these two, especially the peer mentoring and the younger revivalist mentorship that you are doing, I can't help but wonder, you know, in the first, the older leader benefit mentoring that you've participated in, you are at the, you know, you're the younger leader, you're submitting yourself to this process, you received that email and you had the option, should I say yes or should I say no? So now I wonder, have you in your peer mentoring as well as your younger revivalist mentoring, have you had perhaps leaders whom you really want to work with and learn from and learn with, but who have been a little reluctant? You know, you haven't met, your zeal and your anxiety and your excitement hasn't met the same from their end. And how have you dealt with some of those experiences, if you have had them?
Let me see if I understand the question. Older leaders that maybe are not matching that zeal, is that what you're saying?
Yeah. No, so I'm talking about this younger leader mentoring relationship that you have. Like, have you always found the same engagement, excitement, zeal in every one of them that you are pouring your life into and that you are journeying with? Or have there been cases where maybe some of them are not quite, you know, their commitment to the process is not probably what you desire it to be for the sake of the growth of that relationship? And how did you deal with that?
Yeah, got it. Yeah, great question. Yes. So so in this initial group, we invited 14, and now we 12 of them are connected to this. I think it's very natural because two of them, you know, feel that it wasn't their calling in this season, which we're totally blessed in you know, say, you know, right. Go for it, what you feel in this calling. So I think it in my original group of the women, you know, originally we were one of the women during the process, she just sensed that it was not for her anymore. She was going through things. And I think there's freedom too. There's something, oh, we don't need everyone to be there. We just want right. The people who are there that want to be there would be committed. There's no problem with some people letting go in the process. And it's actually, more life-giving to have the people there who want to be there and are committed than to be, you know, forcing the others. So we have people drop out in both groups. And I think it's part of the process. It's human. And, you know, any small groups in church, anyone involved in leadership knows that that's happened. But I would say just go with the ones that are there and focus on this.
Great. Well, thank you. Thanks, Sarah, for sharing that. That's really helpful. You know, I speak from a Cameroonian context where very often, I think there is a big gap in the mentorship relationships within the Christian circles here. And some of that, I think, has to do with even the pain and the hurt that people have experienced in relationships with other Christians in the past. And so it can be very frustrating sometimes, both for the mentor and the mentee, when that relationship is not in that freedom that you just described, that freedom which is rooted not in my desire for this person or their desire for me, but in God's desire for both of us and how we can connect together in that. And that highlights the other thing about you, which I think is really significant, how you mentor people and you benefit from these relationships, not out of personal ambition, but out of this deep, deep sense of a desire for revival, both in your personal life as a leader and then in the lives of the people that you are mentoring. That is very, very significant to highlight.
Yeah. Well, Sarah, I remember the years leading up to WellG 2016, and on the WellGen Facebook group, you often shared with us that you were spending time reading the Bible from cover to cover in the preparation period with your pens and, you know, noting and doing inductive Bible studies. And often you shared about spending time in intimacy with the Father. Why was that so important to you, especially in that period of preparing for WellG 2016?
Yeah, thanks for the question, Paul. I don't say this to over-spiritualize or something, but for me personally, if it isn't rooted in the clarity of calling of God's voice and enjoying of on his strength, I just honestly, I don't think I can do it. You know, like it's almost like when it's a wave in the beach, when the waves are coming at you so high, you have to kind of dive deeper into the waves to survive. That was similar to experience that I had with YOG, because at times it was so hard. all I could do was to draw to the source, you know, and sometimes all I could do is just to go, God's like, God, help, like scream for help. Like, I don't know, have no idea how we're going to do this. But to have that daily drawing and drinking, honestly, it's what keeps me going, both for YFG, which was hard, but also for Revive, that it's right now, it's been 3 to 4 years. It's equally, if not more challenging process with Revive Europe, but it is coming from something that I know that is part of God's heart. And as the daily and weekly challenges come in, if I can drink daily from the source and have that, and just have that really raw time with God and be filled in Him and trusting that He would overcome the challenge, for me, that's personally, that's the only way I could find it, do it. So for YOG was reading, I had a 3-year journey reading through scripture that fed me incredibly. For the first edition of Revive, it was times of worship. I just found a new kind of love language with God through worship. And this year for second Revive, I'm going through that whole reading the Bible cover to cover again, which has been so refreshing. But for me, it's less about the methods of how to do it, but I need that place of like, I need to hear His voice. I can't go without His voice. I can't, you know, and I need to express to Him in a deep soul level of what I'm going through and have that connection. It's the only way that for me, I can navigate these kind of things. Yeah.
Well, it's beautiful to see your heart longing for this intimacy with God. And oftentimes I've heard you say having a heart for the Father. And, you know, sometimes we use different names to talk about God. We talk about God, a Lord, a King. How is it special for you to connect with the heart of God as Father for us and for you?
Yeah, thank you for asking. I have this, my favorite movie is Les Miserables, the Miserables, you know, that movie. And there's a scene of this movie that I think is my favorite scene of every single movie is when Jean Valjean, he adopts this little girl, you know, and she adopts this little girl and he's going this the chariot and she's in his chariot and he sings a song of delight of just finding new love with the little girl. And for me, it's my favorite scene because it's such a good picture of how I feel close to God. You know, that moment of having His joy over me. And I know that I'm completely safe in His arms. So to finding God as Father has been very freeing, and to differentiate my earthly Father, which I adore, but as all human fathers have limitations, and to see my Father in heaven is the perfect one, you know, and have language. The last 2 months I've been finding God as warrior, you know, as protector, and just having new languages to describe. You can't get enough. It's like a diamond that you see different faces and finding His character. So for me, it's just this place of discovering new characters that He's showing me in a different season.
Wow. If I had to ask you if you had a favorite Bible verse, what would you say?
Yeah. It out of YOG actually came John 15:5. I have it here with me. I have my Bible here. It says, I'm the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. This verse 12 years ago or some time ago used to bother me because it sounded too dramatic. Like, apart from me, you can do nothing. It just sounded like, you know, that's not exactly, but I've been finding this is so true. There's no eternal fruit. There's no eternal fruit that we can bear apart from Jesus. And it's just the most basic thing that all Christians know that, yes, other dependence on Jesus, that's so basic. But I've been finding that it's still the most profound truth. Like, if we drink and stay close to Him, that's how we bear fruit. That's how we hear His voice. That's how He will give dreams that is out of His heart. That's how He will give us the strength to face. So for me, this verse is what I drink daily, of finding that place of intimacy with Him and having my life bearing fruit out of this place of connection, of intimacy, of friendship, of leadership, and I serving and I'm obeying and having fear of God over it. So that's my favorite verse. Thanks for asking.
Wow. And how to connect with this issue of mentoring, how does mentoring help you develop your intimacy with God? Mm-hmm. At maybe different levels, if you think of the experience you've shared with now today, with us today.
I think mentoring, so Anne Grizzle, which I mentioned before, she's also a spiritual director, which is a place of someone that helps you to listen God's voice. Like often when I'm one-on-one with her, like, this is what I sense that God is telling me, like in having a sounding board and someone that is listening to God with you. And currently, so two people, Lindsay Olsberg, she's been walking with me for a long time, from 2013, but recently every month we meet. And I have the time that I can, you know, share honest struggles and what I'm trying to listen from God. And most of the times her answer is like, not answer, but her comment would be, what do you sense God is saying this time? You know, what is God telling you? And she would say, should we spend time in silence and listen? So we listen, you know, and see what Jesus says. So having a mentoring as someone has helped me finding out. And I can't do this podcast without mentioning Ole Magnus, you know, which is the person from mentoring that does this group. He, for 3 years in YOG, he was like, for every battle, for every struggle, every joy, he was always there. Ole Magnus says that his life is being alongside that. I've experienced that in every level, just complete reliable and always with us and cheering us on. And it's just such a model for us to have the senior leaders that have that kind of commitment to younger leaders. So Ole Magnus have helped me just by his presence and by being there whenever I need it.
Wow. And so would that be a criterion for you in choosing a spiritual mentor, this longing that you see in the person to be not alongside just you in your leadership, but also listening to the voice of God and being intimate with God?
Yeah, I think I'll draw back to Mark's comment about the constellation of mentors. And I really do believe in that there are different people in different seasons from different things. So for example, When I wanted to learn and still wanted to more about evangelism and how to share my faith and be trained, I researched in Cape Town 2010. I've met Becky Pippard, and I've been, you know, a fan from her for all my life, read her books and everything. And I asked Becky, would you be willing to walk with me? And I still walk with Becky. And for me, she's a mentor in the sense of early years when people were coming to Christ here in Italy. And I would write to Becky, it's like, we're inviting someone tonight. How should I, you know, she will walk me through it of how to invite a person to become a Christian. And I've learned so much about evangelism with Becky through YLG. When I wanted to hear someone perspectives about different regions of the world and how to do with different cultures, I'll call Lindsay Brown. He knows, you know, all the regions and has global leadership experience throughout his life. And he walked through that area, or Doug Bielsa will help with fundraising and things. So different people, I've looked for different kind of areas that I respect and admire and I wanted to learn in different ways. And I think there's wisdom of that. It's just recognizing gifts and what people bring. And if they, you know, I felt so privileged that I could learn from areas that I respected from these leaders. So I think to your question, it depends on the area that I'm looking for. And for Anne Grizzle and Lindsay Osberg, I was really looking for a safe place to share my soul and help to listen, to hear God's voice and have that soundboard that will listen with me.
Wow, and it seems so important today in a day where we often put forward, you know, the an outward appearance, you know, of success, but to have, like you said, people with whom you can just share your heart and listen to God's heart, and to remember, as I've often heard you say, Sarah, that you're a daughter, a son of God, and that's the foundation of your identity. And When you talk about revival, I was just wondering if you could give us, because you're involved in this Revive conference for university students in Europe, and you have a heart for Europe as a Brazilian. Could you tell us a bit more about this heart for revival? How would you define revival, and why is it so much on your heart?
Yes, good question. Complex question. How would you define revival? You know, I'm still studying it and still looking. And I've been finding also freedom and clarity to see what is the role that I'm bringing in this longing for revival. And I'm not the most, you know, intellectual, theological. Like, I feel that my role is mostly the heart of someone that I bring before God, a heart for revival. And for me, it came out of what I felt what God was inviting to prepare for revival. A bit of like Noah for me, it was weird, but it was almost like build an ark, and I'm like, what for? Like, or like prepare this thing without knowing when the rain was going to come, how would it look like, without knowing exactly what revival is. But it consumed my heart so much that I knew I had to build this ark without knowing of rain, of how it would play out. So I just know I felt called to prepare this generation alongside many other things here in Europe happening already, but to be part, play a role of prepare this generation for a revival in Europe and for the student generation. And it has been, again, first that I've experienced in my life, and I was trying to make sense in my life to understand, and out of that came a calling for Revive Europe. But as crazy as it was for Noah, I believe it's also crazy for this generation, but God was faithful. And I believe that one day we'll see, you know, we'll see the rain and we'll get the definitions and the whole theology and historical of it. But for me, my little part has been as try as best as I can to listen and obey. That's the part I felt to play with, to prepare the way with Revive Europe.
Wow, thank you so much, Sarah. We just love hearing you and hearing your heart for God, your heart for people, and seeing people connect with God as Father. I have a question for you, a final question, a little bit to wrap up. But if you had one last word of encouragement to give us in the Well Gen family, both, you know, younger leaders, but also senior leaders who are involved in mentoring younger leaders in our midst, what would be one final word of encouragement you would like to give us?
I would say, take the time you need to listen to God's voice. There's nothing like listening to God's voice, you know? It took 4 months and a half for me after YLG to hear his voice again and clarity that he came for a revive. But once he spoke, I can go a decade with it, you know? Once he was clear about YLG, it took me 3 years that it brought me back that anchoring. So what I would say in my heart is that as younger leaders, as emerging, there's nothing more precious, more important, more strategic, more whatever you can name it, than truly being a place of posture of like, God, I want to hear your voice. I want to hear what you have. And dreams that are birthed out of his voice, out of his hearts, then he's the one that fulfills it. So yeah, take the time you need and the energy you need and the intentionality it takes to hear God's voice and obey it.
Well, thank you so much, Sarah, for being with us today on the podcast, Conversation with a Mentor. We really feel blessed and encouraged to be sharing with you and sharing friendship with you. Our prayer is that all that you shared, you know, may sparkle some great and deep spiritual conversations among the Well Gen community, but also with our senior leaders, peer mentors, and younger leaders that we're investing in, that we may draw closer to the heart of the Father and learn to live being dependent on him and hearing his voice. So thank you so much, Sarah.
Oh, absolute joy. Thank you, Paul, Della, and Mark. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Wow, what a conversation we have had just listening to Sarah share. Thank you so much, Sarah, for sharing. And you know, sometimes as you listen to people talk about their experiences and share what they've learned on this journey, especially as far as mentoring is concerned, sometimes it can be so much that it's hard for you to tell. Now, what do I do with all of this information? What do I take down? And that's why, Mark, you're such a wonderful contributor to this podcast in the way you're able to boil things down. Now, there are people watching, there are people listening to us going, so what is the main thing here? What can I take away from what Sarah Breuel had to share besides all the moving experiences and stories of revival and just the tenderness in her walk with the Father? You know, you could tell that she was so, so, so tender in that part of her life. So please, Mark, boil this down for us. What are some of those key nuggets that the listeners and the younger leaders who are listening to this podcast can take home from this conversation?
Thank you, Delphine. But boy, that's a hard assignment because there were so many nuggets. And like you said, so much of what she said and how she said it, we heard her heart, was so beautiful. But let me share with you what struck me. I'll share three words. First, pursue. And I would say pursuing a relationship with a senior mentor, younger leader, if you're a senior leader, take initiative and pursue initiating something like Ann Grizzle did to launch this mentoring group for younger leaders. And likewise, if you're a younger leader, sometimes you pursue a relationship with a senior leader and take the initiative to ask them to mentor you or even launch a group. So I would say pursue, but it works both ways. Pursue that relationship. But secondly, I'd say journey together. And this whole idea of a mentoring constellation, that it doesn't just depend upon having a senior leader with younger leaders, but the role of peer mentoring and the role of someone also then investing in someone younger than them. No matter who we are, there is always some people younger than us that we can invest in. You may be 24 years old and be able to invest in high school students. So the idea of peer mentoring and younger and investing in younger groups, younger leaders in that mentoring constellation journey. And I love the way she put it. She said, who are the people that I'm called to journey with, where iron sharpens iron? So that could be in peers or with younger leaders or with senior leaders, but journey together. So pursue, journey together. And then thirdly, there at the end, we heard her heart. I would say drink, drink. That deals with the revival and intimacy. She said, I need to drink daily from the source and the place where I can hear God's voice and express to God what is going on in my life. And she said, take time to listen to God's voice. That was one of her final words to us. And I know here in the YLG and Wild Gen movement, we are particularly after prayer and discernment, we are focusing upon John chapter 13 to John 17 to integrate that passage of the upper room discourse in all that we do. And here Sarah shared her favorite verse, John 15:5, to abide in the vine, and Jesus is the vine, we're the branches, and how no eternal fruit can be born apart from Christ. So true. I often like to say we need to abide in the vine so we can abound in fruit, and the fruit bearing comes from abiding in the vine. So drinking deeply and taking that time, and in our mentoring relationships, mutually growing in that intimacy of listening to the Father's voice and drinking deeply from that source. So pursue relationships with senior mentors and younger leaders, journey together in a mentoring constellation of senior, peer, and younger leaders, and then drink daily from the source in revival and intimacy with our Father.
Wow. Thank you. That really boils it down. Pursue, journey together, and drink daily. Awesome. Thanks, Mark.
Oh, many thanks, Delphine. Many thanks, Mark, for this this great time today. It was so enriching. And we feel blessed to having had this conversation. I'm sure you are too, right?
Absolutely. For me, it was really deep and very encouraging. And I mean, we've said this over, I don't think we can say it enough, in the day and age where we live, where it's so easy to drift away from that relationship, that kind of depth in the relationship with the Lord that Sarah not only pursues, but enjoys, as you can tell from every little thing that she shared. It has really been a really breathtaking to see that, and very refreshing at the same time to have her share that. Very, very great stories that she had to share with us.
I would certainly agree, Della, and you said breath taking, and I'd say and the breath of the Spirit breathing revival in our own souls, and then also amongst through our mentoring groups and through our ministries, and our world needs that. Our church, the broader church needs that fresh breath of intimacy with the Father. And and joy of him singing over us in his delight as his children. And so, God willing, let's see that happen in this time.
Amen. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today on this podcast. You can find the replay of the episode on the Connector app and also on our Wild Gen Facebook group. Let's continue also to have some conversations in the comment section of the Facebook group and with one another. in our peer mentoring relationships, also with senior mentors in Lausanne. Let's continue to build soul friendships for global missions, and we'll see each other for our next episode of this podcast, A Conversation with a Mentor. Goodbye and take care.